This is Duke University.
But let's go ahead and get started while y'all, and help yourself to food and refreshments. I'm going to give about a two-minute intro, and then we'll start our conversation. First of all, I want to welcome you for being here, and thank you for coming. I'm David Malone. I'm the faculty director of the Duke Service Learning Program. The Service Learning Program is housed in Arts and Sciences within the program in education, and I want to thank Dean Laurie Patton, who is Dean of Arts and Sciences, and Professor Jan Rigsby. Jan, you in here? Chair of the Program in Education, for their support of the Service Learning Program. Professor Malone, I have saved you a seat right up here. Y'all know Professor Malone, that's my older brother right here.
That's why I need a seat.
We now have about 80 courses at Duke that have a community-based learning component in about 30 different departments. And I believe we have several faculty members here who teach service learning courses, community-based learning courses. And maybe you could raise your hand, faculty members. Yeah, so students, check them out and get involved. I think we have departments, theater studies, English, education, Spanish, documentary studies, Asian and Middle Eastern studies. Barbara, you're in documentary studies. Your course is listed there. And cultural anthropology. So if you want some more information about service learning, you can pick up some materials that we have around, or you could ask our service learning team, Amy Anderson, incredible Amy Anderson, and the incredible Kristen Wright. Kristen coordinated today's events. Let's give it up. We want to thank our colleagues for being here today. One of the great things about working at Duke is if you send an email to your colleagues and say, we would love to have your support in this event that we're sponsoring, people show up, and I like that. So we've got some folks here from Duke Engage. We have Bill Wright Swaddell from the Career Center. Duke Center for Civic Engagement is represented, Student Affairs, Durham and Regional Affairs, Religious Life, the Office of Undergraduate Scholars and Fellows, Duke Libraries, Pauli Murray Project, the Franklin Humanities Institute, the Duke Human Rights Center, and we have the Advising Center here. I want to especially thank all of you students for coming and taking the time to be here on a Friday. We know how busy you are this time of year with midterms, and I think we have some student groups represented here, Duke Partnership for Service. We have some of our Duke scholars here, the Chronicle, very represented. DSG, we got, and I think we have Duke football represented, is that correct? I like that. Do you have any other athletic teams represented here today? I think we have crew, yes. Rowing, yeah. How many of you students have taken a class that involves some kind of community-based learning component? Raise your hand, yeah. Well, good. Amy, give them up, give it up for the students. So we have hot off the press our list of 2013 community-based learning classes, and if you want one of those, Kristen will give you one at the end. So thanks for being here. I know some of the students have told me they have a class that might start at 12:50, 1 o'clock, so if somebody gets up and needs to get up and leave, just get up and leave. But remember my motto, never let your classes get in the way of your education. So, the format for today's conversation, I'm going to offer some context of why we're here, and then I'm going to ask Dean Patton to share her thoughts, and then hopefully we can have a give-and-take conversation, and you will feel comfortable jumping in. You're probably wondering, why is the Service Learning Program hosting a conversation that's called Aristotle or Astrophysics Beyond Binaries? Well, today's conversation is actually kind of the culminating event in some ways for a year-long theme that we picked last summer in the Service Learning Program called Connected Knowing and Integrated Learning. Because those of us who teach service learning courses are very interested in this theme, because at the very heart of service learning is an attempt to connect learning that occurs in the community, experiential learning, with learning that occurs in the academic classroom. So you have the real world on the one hand, and the academic classroom on the other. And you see, I just did it. I created a binary. the real world, and then the classroom. Theory and practice, thought and action. So these binaries are tricky things, and if we're not careful, they're going to get us in some trouble. The great English utilitarian philosopher Jeremy Bentham said, "There are two types of people in this world, those who divide the world into two types of people and those who do not." And I think there are a lot of us here at Duke that fall into this tendency to divide our Duke world. That's what we're talking about here today, our own Duke world, into binaries. So I was thinking, what are some ones that I've heard over the years? Well, arts and sciences, curricular, co-curricular. Oh, that's a humanities person. That's a math and science person. Oh, I need to do this to prepare myself for a job. Oh, I'm doing this because I'm really interested in it. Oh, this is for my resume. Oh, this is for my life. Independent, Greek. Y'all heard that one before? Work hard, play hard. That's an old one. That's an 80s one. Still around today. My parents' major, what my parents want me to major in. My major, my passion major. Jocks, nerds. Wall Street types, Peace Corps types. I've never really heard anybody say, that's a Peace Street type or that's a Wall Corps type. So I think perhaps in unintended ways, we let these binaries get in our way of fully engaging with our community. And we have asked someone here today who I think is incredible, Dean Laurie Patton, for her ability to understand cultures and to create and facilitate a conversation around important issues. And we're hoping today that this conversation will help us grow and develop as a learning community. So without further ado, let's welcome and give it up for Professor of Religion and Dean of Arts and Sciences, Laurie Patton.
Thank you all very much. And it's really wonderful to be back here again and to hang out with some of my favorite folks at Duke for any number of reasons. I don't think I shared with you earlier that one of the funniest moments for me as I was beginning to think about this larger question of integrative education was when I came here the last time. As you may probably understand, sometimes I have time to only read the first two lines of an email. And so I had thought I was coming to a small seminar of David's in a classroom somewhere. And when I walked into this room, there were over 100 people, and there was the Chronicle and everything else. And I just went, all righty then, let's just keep going. But it was definitely a Duke moment. And it was an incredibly exciting one to see the interest and the engagement around this question, which is, as you could probably see, such a clear passion of mine. And working with David on any number of different contexts, some highly political ones and some more contemplative ones, has just been a great joy, and with many, many other people in this room as well. And having the chance to interact with students is just a great relief for me on any number of levels. Teaching was one of my passions that I had to give up, and or at least give most of it up in becoming a dean. And so it's always nice to get back in touch with students. I also want to say that as a result of the conversation we had last time about what's your question, the Facebook page, the event that happened after the what's your question conversation, and I've done maybe four or five smaller group conversations with faculty, mostly with students, but some with faculty, on that what is your question. I think we almost have a movement on our hands, and I'm really delighted about that. The number one reason why I'm delighted about that, and I keep featuring it, I sent it immediately to the president. He was also psyched. By the way, the president knows about this, as well as the provost, is that it's about a culture taking responsibility for itself in terms of change. And I'm very willing to continue to work with all of you, even those of you who are graduating, to think about ways we could institutionalize some of this in such a way that it doesn't become, you know, just another check off the box. I think one way that we've done that already that's been very exciting is our academic homecoming that happened when people choose their majors. And I had many different conversations when I went under that tent and then welcomed everybody into a major about what their question was and their relationship between their question and their major. Because sometimes it's a really direct relationship and sometimes it's not. I will say that one of the things that happened when I was in a small group talking about that, what is that question you'll never be tired of asking and you'll never fully know the answer to, there were a few folks who started to feel bad that they didn't have a question. And I want to make sure people stop doing that right away. The whole point is not to make an achievement issue or credentializing issue out of whether you have a question. The point is to enjoy finding the question as you go along. And there were several people who were sort of feeling really good that they had a question. And I wanted to say to those people, don't make feel the other people who don't have a question feel that they haven't done something yet, please. So I would say we could think about this as a movement, and I would love to continue to work on these conversations. And perhaps the next steps for us might be brainstorming some very specific ways that we could create conditions for which integrated learning could happen, or more possibilities for integrated learning, which is very different than creating a set of bureaucratic structures. How do we make a community so the conditions are possible is another kind of planning, and I think that would be the direction that I'd like to move in. And we had some great conversations in the Chronicle from students around this, as well as some ideas which I think we can follow up on. So delighted to continuing the conversation, and would like to suggest that we might even be more pragmatic with the help of the Program in Education and the Service Learning Program and in our next steps. So today we're kind of taking the next step in the intellectual conversation about kind of building from what a question is, because what that question is something that integrates everything in your life and everything that you are, that you can see a touchstone for all activities that you have around that question. And one of the things I did in a dinner with some students the other day was to share what my question was, and then talk about every book that I'd written and all the administrative stuff that I do and how it's related to that question. Reminder for those of you who are here, and to let you know for those of you who weren't, my question was, what is the role of the poet in society? Everything I do has to do with that question, whether it's studying ancient Sanskrit literature, doing ethnography of contemporary women who teach Sanskrit in India, thinking about voices and young people gaining a voice also has to do with what is the role of a poet in society, if you think about poetry in the larger sense of coming to voice. So there's lots of different ways, and I won't go over all those now, although I'm happy to talk about those in the back and forth conversation. But I think David's points are really, really apt today about how we get into binaries. And I wanted to talk a little bit about binaries from the perspective of my own field, and it's actually quite related to something that David said earlier. And that is one of the reasons why people are attracted to Indian culture, and particularly ancient India and early Indian texts and philosophy, is that it's the place that people go to move beyond Western binaries of self and other, of a body and spirit, of matter and mind. Those are the three basic dichotomies that the West and the Western religious tradition gets stereotyped into saying, well, we've got all these binaries, and St. Augustine, it's probably all his fault, and maybe it was the Jews' fault before them, and so forth. These are very stereotypical conversations around the West. And some people in religious searching and writing from really, the early first millennium onwards, have tried to turn to Indian texts to overcome these binaries, because many Indian texts are really about the merging of those two things, and of about the relationship between mind and matter, or the merging of the self into that larger force that animates the whole universe, which is called Brahman. And so there's a lot of attraction by the West for Eastern texts for these reasons, for Indian texts in particular for these reasons. And so one of the things I do when I teach this material is I put on the board the following statement, which is, unlike the West, comma, which has binaries, comma, India does not, which is another binary, exactly as David was saying. And so we're constantly in this trap where no matter how many times we want to make a distinction, we are creating another binary to get out of the binary. And so it's kind of endless. And so what do you do about that intellectually? You can throw up your hands and say, okay, forget it, you know, binaries are binaries and we're doomed and it's kind of an intellectual form of original sin. Or we can do the other thing, which is to say, wow, the whole computer system that we benefit from enormously today is based on binaries. And so it's a really good thing. So let's embrace it, which I just formulated two approaches, which itself was a binary, right? So we have this constant way of thinking and distinguishing, which does move in twos. And sometimes we move to threes, and sometimes we move to four, and sometimes we move to a matrix, which is called our curriculum. Right? So there's various levels of complexity on the scale that we can move up and down on when it comes to binaries. A Buddhist approach, which is both highly intellectual and philosophical, as well as very much of the body and mind and spirit. The Sanskrit word mana, by the way, manas, in Sanskrit, you can't say it means either heart or mind. It means both, right? So you have lots of words in India, and I think in the West too, if we think about it, that have connotations of both things, which are usually put in binaries. But if we really take a more of a Buddhist philosophical approach to binaries, then we're actually doing something quite different, which is to say, binaries aren't bad or good. They're just there. They're just what we do. And the key thing is to find both a right relationship between the two elements in the binaries and our right relationship to the binary, right? So number one, the binary is not a bad thing. It's just a thing we do. And how do we therefore relate to it as thinkers? It's a very important question. And studiers and students. And the second thing is, how do we then reconfigure our relationship, the relationship between the two things? That's the challenge for, in my view, integrated learning, is making that relationship right. And there's a number of different ways that we could do that. So what I thought I'd do as we continue to talk about this, as I articulated a principle right now, and it's a it's a twofold principle, one of which is the right relationship to the binary, and the second is right relationship between the two elements in the binary, is begin to push against stereotyping of ourselves and our own lives, because part of what David said and what I've said and the implications of binaries is that they can lead to stereotypes almost instantly. And that's part of what we want to transcend. Another way that I would put this principle that is so important for all of us is dualisms aren't a problem, binaries aren't a problem, unless they put obstacles in the way to your intellectual curiosity and to your sense of purpose in life. And if they don't, then there's no reason why there should be a problem with them. And I think that's a very, very important thing. You need to also ask yourself, in the spirit of the principle I just articulated, the question is the binary that I'm dealing with getting in the way of my own curiosity and my own sense of purpose in life? Because curiosity and purpose are the reason why I constantly ask people what their question is. We also did I forgot to mention, we did an exercise with alumni on this, which was also very, very fun, a group of women leaders at Duke. And so that is a way I would now begin to open up. And I'm gonna share with you some next comments, but before I do, I'd like to hear other binaries in addition to the ones that David and I have been talking about. Are there other ones that you could share with us that come from your Duke experience in particular? Because that's really what we're talking about, although they don't have to come from your Duke experience.
Scholar-athlete.
Scholar-athlete, right, related to the nerd and the jock. Okay, good. Yes. Liberal arts and pre-professional, good. Do you think that was a binary 50 years ago? Right, good. I think that's right. When I was born, 1 year before I was born, there was no tension between the liberals and pre-professionals. Okay, I saw a hand. There was another hand vaguely somewhere. There it was. Hi.
Male or female?
Male or female? Okay, very important. Great. Others. Yes.
White versus other.
White versus other, good. Others. Oh, yes, hey, Kristen.
The question that I came up with last time here has a binary tenet, which is equity and excellence.
Good. Which is the key tension in all of education in a certain way, or access and excellence. Good. Okay. These are all really good ones, and I wanted to share people to share some of their binaries or the things that they struggle with, because it does give a really good picture of what a community is struggling with. This looks like a lot of other communities of higher education. But yeah, David has one.
I got one.
Good.
I was riding the bus the other day. You know how everybody's declaring their majors as sophomores?
Yeah.
So I overheard this conversation. You learn a lot on the bus. Somebody said, well, what are you majoring in? And the person said, I'm majoring in English. And then the other person said, well, what are you going to do with that?
Right.
And then the other person said, English isn't a major that you do something with. It's a major about who you are. So it was a pretty good conversation.
Right.
But it had this sort of doing versus being right. kind of binary.
Yeah. Good. That's great. So we just to go through some of the list again and get you to think about some of these concerns. So we have white versus other, equity versus excellence, scholar versus athlete, liberal arts versus pre-professional, male, female. Doing, being, Peace Corps, Wall Street, humanities, social science, work hard, play hard, interesting, curricular, co-curricular, parents major, passion major. Those are all binaries that I think are worthy of our contemplation. And I think what's important about, as soon as we name it as a binary, the next step for us is now to do what I suggested that we do, which is to first of all think about what our relationship to that binary is, and second of all to think about the relationship between the two elements. And I know this is a highly intellectual exercise, but once you do it, it's really, really interesting and fun. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the next steps after we do this exercise. So I want to ask, how many of you gave the example of a binary that you felt good about, that you really liked? Right, everyone's going, ew. Right, I notice very real expressions on your face. Okay, how many of you gave an example of a binary that you're presently struggling with in some way or other? Okay, see, yeah, good, several, okay. How many of you gave an example of a binary that you have active hostility towards? Or that you don't like that it exists as a binary? Okay, some. All right, good. So other thoughts for those of you who did give examples, or even ones where you don't have, you didn't give an example, about what your particular attitude to that binary is. Any thoughts about what the struggles are, or what the ambivalence is, or I didn't see any real love and devotion for any of them, but I have a couple that I really like, but I'll share those with you later. I'll share them with you later. Yes.
Well, mine is action and reflection, which is sort of the principle of service learning.
Yeah.
And that is how I found the way to integrate them through service learning.
That's great.
So my attitude until I discovered service learning was, how can I both do and be and reflect on the being and the doing and
put them together.
One of our service learning students used to say that the hyphen in service and learning is the reflection.
Nice. That's a great example of wanting to put two things together, not quite knowing how, and finding a place where that could possibly happen, or an activity. Good. Anybody else in terms of? Yes.
I think some of them are very false.
Uh-huh.
I think the relationship between the two is very
arbitrary false. So
right.
when you were asking, I was thinking town gap. This is
right.
a classic one. And, you know, I talk about that a lot in my class, but that's a false binary. You need to embrace something that looks more like and also.
Good. I think this is a really central point in the following way. Part of what we're trained to do as students and as scholars is to take positions and make arguments and make those distinctions. It's what we have to do in order to, like, every day, you know, and it's actually the most intense I've ever had to be. I have to make an argument on behalf of something with evidence probably every hour of my job, every hour. And it's an incredible intellectual sort of challenge to constantly be in that executive mode with arguments. And I have to make an advocacy argument pretty much every hour that is about that. And if I don't do it well, or if I forget something, I lose $1 million sometimes, $3 million. Sometimes it's $5, whatever it is. It's a lot at stake all the time. And so what's interesting is we get paid to do this. Right? We get trained to do this, to make those arguments. And if we're good at it, even better. And so the difference between the verses, which gets us a lot of good things, right? In fact, I had to make an argument to make sure we had funds to redo this room about 2 weeks ago. Right? That, and I did binaries there, right? So maybe when we redo this room, we'll know that it's thanks to a binary that we were able to do it. But and also is much harder to think about in academic life. And also tends to be boring. And also tends to be inclusive, yay, but does it really make clear, distinct arguments? And most of the time, the answer is no. And that's part of the world that I think we are all struggling with, is how do we, and here's another one, right? How do we deal with something that should be or can be both and versus in our lives? Yes, ma'am.
I think that the assumption that in order to make an argument for or against a certain action, requiring a binary might be flawed. Sorry.
No. This is why we're here.
Just because, like, for example, like when you look for cause and effect in history, like you don't sit down and say, like, Napoleon woke up on the left side of the bed, or he woke up on the right side of the bed, therefore Waterloo.
You never know, but
you look at like Waterloo's like the collusion of like three different. I'm not going to use Waterloo as an example. That seems like it's going to fundamentally hurt me in some way.
This is a very nonviolent group, my guess is.
Yeah. But, I mean, like, in history, like, yeah. we have an event, and then you have, like, 16 books taking 13 yeah. sides, and all of them saying, like, while there's validity to this, there might also be validity to that. And
right.
it's fairly inclusive, I would argue.
Absolutely. I think that's right. And I think all the best intellectual analyses are multiple in precisely the way that you're arguing. Absolutely right. I do think that there are forms of, and what I was speaking about was not the nature of intellectual argument, which I think should be multiple, and certainly in certain kinds of discourse, particularly historical discourse, but in other discourses as well. But also, more importantly, the nature of our intellectual culture, which tends, it doesn't have to be always this way, but it tends to be this way. If I said to the provost yesterday, I think that Arts and Sciences' donation of $3 million to that particular thing is a really good thing, but or is going to be a really expensive thing, and therefore we need to really think clearly if we do more than that. But I can also see the other side. I would have lost $3 million. You see what I'm getting at, right? And it's not just administrative work. It's in, you know, all of our different cultural spheres and so on. So I think what you're saying is really important, because it's about how we move to the next level culturally, where we can hold multiple things in our heads and just assume that there are multiple things in our heads in a both and kind of way. And that sometimes is hard, easier to do intellectually than it might be culturally. So remind me of your name. Yara, okay, yeah. So I think that Yara's point is really important, because I think our challenge is to do exactly what Yara's talking about, which is being aware of when we've lost hold of the multiplicity that now is our lives. I think I mentioned the last time, but if I didn't, and it's very much building on this conversation we just had, something that Charlie knows a lot about, and that is a book by Thompson called, edited book called The Clumsy Solution. And that is a book that basically says, y'all, the big problems, questions, issues of the day, water, food, air, poverty, inequality, et cetera, there's never going to be a single magic bullet. That's the scientific romanticism of the 20th century. And we're always going to have a clumsy solution of multiple approaches. It's how we're beginning to cure AIDS. It's how we're beginning to cure cancer, and so on. And so let's continue to work on the assumption of those multiple approaches as we move forward in our cultural lives as well as in our intellectual lives. It's a great, great book, by the way. I would recommend it. It's called The Clumsy Solution. And the other cool thing about it is that it's not elegant. It's very clumsy, and everything kind of overlaps, and no one knows who belongs, and there's constant dialogue about which approach is better, and yet they're all at the table. And that's kind of where the Bass Connections is trying to move, and a number of different other kind of Duke Immerse and so on at Duke. So when dualisms are a problem is when they become obstacles to intellectual curiosity and sense of purpose. So I outlined, just in thinking about my conversation with you today, five different areas when they might become an obstacle like this. And so I thought I'd share them with you, and I'm sure there's many more that I'd love to hear from this group. And then after I share those five ways, I thought I'd talk a little bit about how we might think about reconfiguring the relationship between the two elements in the binary so that they restore our sense of curiosity and purpose, very similar to the story we just heard about service learning. So the first way when they become an obstacle is when one in the binary is has to win, when you feel like one element of the binary has to win. So there's a kind of antagonistic relationship between the two. If we think about humanities, and I'm going to just use the examples that David gave as examples that we could talk about. So if we think about humanities and sciences, exactly that feeling sometimes is the case, which is, and it's like doing and being. Are the sciences going to win? Can the humanities win over the sciences? Quite frequently when I have conversations between scientists and humanists, and I do so all the time in study groups, had one on religion and science in the context of Tibet in my previous incarnation. One of the things I said or observed was the conversation always goes something like this. Suddenly, the humanistic study of religion shows that scientific reasoning is flawed after all. Or suddenly, science can take into account every single humanistic phenomenon through this algorithm or this rule. Right, and both of them, one has to win in that combination. And sometimes we don't even realize that we're falling into that way of thinking. And that can become very counterproductive. So that would be one way. The second, and for instance, and just to go back to that for a second, does the job market or the stigmatization of majors that we've talked about before create a dynamic between those two things where one has to win? So that would be a first example. A second way that it might become an obstacle is when you have a sense that you have to do both and you don't want to do both, right? And I want to just, you know, make a description of all the different kinds of experiences that we might have of binaries. So there's a sense of sort of imposed inclusiveness in the binary. Work hard, play hard is an example. Right? There are times in my world where all I want to do is work hard, and I think, oh, I better play, right? Or, oh, I better play hard. I mean, if I'm playing hard, then I say, oh, I better work. That there's this sense, and that's one of the discourses that you hear a lot around work-life balance. And a lot of people say, balance schmalance. There's no way it's going to happen that it's work and life balance, because then you have to always include both, et cetera. It's rather like this very jerky dance or tango or something that never actually gets the rhythm quite right. So I think it's very, and we see that about the critique of the word balance in the news, right? That both sides have to be represented at all times, and there are certain people who think that there are certain moral issues where the other side shouldn't be represented, and it's not about balance in that case. So that's another time, I think, for folks in certainly higher education where it might undermine our curiosity and sense of purpose. The third is when the two elements don't complement each other. They may not compete, like in the first example, but they just don't find a way to fit together. They feel as if they are constantly moving in separate orbits, and there's no way to put them together. I mean, I think we heard that a little bit earlier. An example here might be David's example of curricular and co-curricular, which is, and you know, I know Bill's working on this all the time. Some people even hate the word co-curricular because it assumes that there will always be this separate orbit for the two elements in the binary. And there's no way you can put them in relationship to each other. And I think that's a very big frustration that a lot of people feel in everyday life in higher education. The fourth is related to that, but it's a slightly different way of thinking about it, which is when there's a chasm between the two elements in a binary that makes it impossible to switch gears, right? And I think gear switching, given our multiple lives and our multiple engagements and all the different things that we do, reminder, 86% of all of our Duke students do two things, and usually more, that when you stop doing one thing, you get disoriented in trying to move to the next thing. I know for faculty, the big, big mode where switching gears feels very, very difficult is to move from teaching to research, sometimes from research to teaching. But they feel like such distinct spheres that when you're done, you know, with your head absolutely at the computer screen or in the midst of an argument of some kind that you want to make for an article you're writing or a lab experiment, to go to the big picture, to go to human engagement, whatever it might be, makes it really, really hard to switch gears. And I think one of the number one skills of a 21st century thinker and leader is around switching gears. That might be true, for instance, in the binary between, say, a parents major and a passion major, right? They're two different modes even of your brain, perhaps, and switching gears between them can feel really disorienting. And finally, the last one is where the two elements of a binary become an obstacle to our curiosity or sense of purpose is you don't understand how they both fit into your life. You want them to fit into your life, but you don't understand how they both can. It's a very existential challenge. You like both things, but it feels like cramming too much into a grocery bag. An example there would be Wall Street and Peace Corps, which is the example that David gave earlier. How could they possibly both fit into my life? And so those are five ways that I think the two elements of a binary can get in the way of our curiosity. I can pause here and see if anyone has any comments or thoughts before I go into some of the ways we might reconfigure the relationships in binaries to maintain our curiosity. Any comments or thoughts or even other examples?
I've got a thought about your idea that binaries are not a problem unless they get in our way of our intellectual curiosity or our sense of purpose. And I think another way they can become a problem, though, is when they get in our way of fully engaging and embracing our community, our sense of being a member of a community. And I think that happens on, so it's not just intellectual curiosity and our sense of purpose, but our relationship to everyone around us. And I think that particularly happens a lot on Duke campus, that students sort of see the world, their community, as being different types of people, that they're one type, but not another type.
Yeah, that's very helpful. Yes?
I mean, it can also be, binaries can also be damaging, not just for a sense of purpose, but for a sense of self. Like, male or female, or like, white or not, the idea that you have to fit cohesively into one box might prevent a person from adequately both understanding themselves and then what they want to do and then how they might do it.
Absolutely, and I think that does interfere. An interfered with sense of self also interferes with a sense of purpose, and sometimes even curiosity. So I think that's exactly right. Yeah.
I don't think I've come to these, but I don't think I've ever said my question. And I think the question, the different parts of your life is a different question and should be. The question, the first quarter of my life and the middle of my life and the end are going to be different. But I think, I know that the question fundamentally has stayed the same since I was
great.
5 years old, 2 years old, 40 years old, 50, whatever. And that is, how do I use my art to help people of different cultures see that they share a humanness that is fundamental, and that in that humanness, that heart of their humanness, they, when they are not afraid, they are less likely to act in anger, to act in violence, that fear, if we can keep people from being afraid of each other, they see how they are like each other. All right, that's, how do I use art? The problem for me all of my life has been not so much a binary, but making a hierarchy. What is a more valuable way to do that? Isn't it better for me to write national television shows, publish novels, other things that I've done in my life, than to go to a hospice center in Orange County and read to people, or to teach a small seminar, or to teach in any way? Or to give time to my family, or to make money so I can stay in my house, or what are the relationships of hierarchy? And one thing, an old friend of mine said a long time ago, he meant it as something I should work through and stop doing. But I took it as a wonderful indicator of that I was doing well and working with binaries and hierarchies. He said, you have no dependent clauses. He never understood the dependent clause. Everything for you is coordinating conjunction. This was a PhD. This was in graduate school. That people taught that. But to see the I will do this, and I will do this, and they're of value to me, of all parts of my question. So we're talking about binaries, but the struggle, and I know it's a struggle for you, is the hierarchy,
right,
and how to get, without being foolish and saying, well, it's just important for me to sit here and have another martini, as it is to go take my midterm. I mean, that's a,
yep.
That's sometimes hierarchies are helpful.
I think that's very important. I think that's related to the example A of one, when one element of a binary has to win, that we do tend to hierarchize in that very way. Other comments before I get to the...
Well, I was thinking another way that I found them to be sort of damaging is the fact that you sort of neglect other options that may be there.
Absolutely.
So when you put so much weight on two sort of choices that you think you have, you can sort of totally neglect other options you might have.
That's right. That's a key conflict mediation principle, by the way, which I use also every day, because we culturally are so trained inclined to think in binaries. And that is at a moment when you have understood and analyzed a conflict and two people in the room dealing with a conflict, then you have this immediate thing that you can do that can put people at their ease, which is what's called exploring options. And that is therefore multiplying other options besides the binary, right? So two people are fighting about the price of a house. You could say, first of all, we could do those two prices. I could give you zero for the house. I could give you $5 million for the house. And then there's all the ones in between. And let's talk about all the different possibilities with no attachment to the position and just thinking about all those different possibilities. And I think that's a really, really great way to free up the sense of damage. Tell me your name.
Paul.
Paul, that Paul was talking about. So any other comments before I get to the, yes ma'am. Remind me of your name.
Sue.
Sue, hi.
One of the problems can also arise when the two elements of the binaries are mutually exclusive. So,
right.
Like, if it's like completely mutually exclusive, then like you're trying to figure out the relationship between two elements rather than the relationship between the yourself and the binaries.
Good.
So that, like, I think that's when you lose the sense of purpose and
right.
all this curiosity and every other important aspect. You tend to like forget why you ask these questions in terms of like trying to figure out the making choices
mm-hmm.
between that two mutually exclusive elements.
Yes.
So I think, yeah.
That's great. I think that's right. Because as soon as you see, you feel as if you only have two choices, then you're going to immediately have a tough relationship to that binary, whatever that is, intellectually and so on. I think are we going to 1:15 or
yeah.
1? Or
how much time we got, Krista?
Okay, I think I should probably go around in about 20 minutes. So, I realize that, yeah, people are going to be coming and going, I think. So I wanted to move on to some ways that we might think about moving beyond binaries in terms of intellectual culture and higher education and the ones that we've been naming, and there are so many others that we could deal with. So this is very pragmatic at the same time as probably also informed by my study of Buddhism. And I have this approach in the dean's office as well, it's pretty much in life, which is all problems are functions of time, space, money, or relationships. Right? All problems are functions of time, space, money, or relationships. So I have four there. Right? I'm sure there's more, but these are the ones that really are useful kind of in the end. So when someone comes to me with a problem, I will say, is this a problem of time? Is this a problem of space and money or a combination of several things? So when people say, for instance, we can't just throw money at that problem, that's a way of saying that there are other things that we need to work on that would be important here. And same with all the other kinds of things. Well, you can't just fix the relationship because we're still in an impoverished place, and therefore that's a function of resources or money. We could maybe even say resources rather than money. So I think that if you take each of these in turn, you can see ways in which you could reconfigure two elements of a binary so that at least you have a number of ways of imagining that binary differently. And the first is exactly what Paul just said, which is adding more to the binary. I'm not saying that we should all the time, because then we're getting back into the idea that binaries are bad, and I don't think they are. But if we need to add more to the binary, then we should, right? There are certain binaries, many of them, you know, bodily ones, like cold versus hot, you know, I'll put a sweater on, or, you know, wet versus dry, you know, I'll take a towel after the shower and so on, which are perfectly good binaries. I wouldn't want to exist in that in-between space. But if we take other things, so let's take time. Time is a really interesting one because I think, for instance, if you take Wall Street and Peace Corps, if you think of the relationship between those two things as a function of staging, then if you want to think of them simultaneously, that might be a little more radical. We could try. I'll get back to that in a second. But as a function of time, you could say there's a time in my life when I will do the Peace Corps and a time in my life when I will do Wall Street. And by the way, I'm on the road fundraising every week for Duke, and all the people that I meet that want to give to higher education, who are really generous, not all of them, but many, many of them, a great number of them, are exactly this kind of person. In fact, I just met with someone the other day who's going to give a really generous gift to Duke. And what's he doing? He can't be as generous as he wants to be because he's literally retiring early and going into the Peace Corps. And so there's lots of folks like that. And then, you know, you could do the Peace Corps earlier, et cetera. But thinking about the relationship between the two elements in terms of time and staging is really important. And I think that's really hard. It was very hard for me to do in college. You guys are probably 10 times smarter and more mature than I was. But I think that can be hard to imagine. An example from my own life would be I was trained as a beginning as an intern in a clinical program in psych and religion, psychology and religion, and decided I really didn't want to do it because at 23 I knew nothing and I had no wisdom. So who was I to say to anybody to sue, by the way, I know how you can heal yourself, when I had no idea how I could heal myself. So that seemed like skill-based and technique-based and not a matter of mind and heart united. So I didn't do that. So I said, when I'm 50, I'll come back and maybe I'll be a clinical psychologist. So I was 50 last year and decided that wasn't what I was going to do. But I did revisit it. So there is this question of time, changing the relationship in terms of time. Space, changing the relationship in terms of space. That would be something like putting Wall Street to work for the Peace Corps. Or putting the Peace Corps to work for Wall Street. Probably we wouldn't want to do the second, some of us, but maybe we would. You know, what would that look like? So space means radically juxtaposing them, and a lot of times space also means reconfiguring the relationship. And I think that's really interesting. So what if the Occupy Wall Street movement started to think about, for instance, putting Wall Street to work for the Peace Corps? Now, what would that look like? And that's a function of both space, right? You'd have an office, you'd be in the same office, as well as reconfiguring the relationship. And there's lots of times where if you're struggling with a binary, if you think about them in the same room or put them at the same desk, two representatives of them, or lock them in a room and see what happens, there's some really interesting new possibilities that come out. The third is money or resources. And one of the things that I think is really interesting there is the concept of a joint degree, right? That's where you're actually using your resources, you're paying tuition for something that assumes at least doubleness. And there's sometimes even triple degrees, not very many, but there are. And that is an example of taking your resources as a way of putting the two things together that you didn't think normally would go together. Or using the resources from one element to help with another. Right, so we get lots of grants in the sciences. One of the things we're doing in arts and sciences is trying to put humanists in touch with people who would normally get grants from scientific foundations like NIH or NSF. Really exciting possibilities there. That would be another way to think about the two elements together in terms of resources. And finally, relationship. And relationship really is related to all these different things. As soon as you think about things simultaneously or staged in time, you can also think about things simultaneously or staged in space. It'll be there one day and, you know, not there another. You can think of the same thing with money. I'll give my money this to this element of the binary today and to that element of the binary tomorrow. You are reconfiguring the relationship. One of the most important, and you can think about, do I want this to be a competitive relationship? Do I want it to be a collaborative relationship between the two elements? Do I want the two elements to be complementary? There are all these different ways in which you need to think about those elements. One element that's actually really, really interesting is of relationship is thinking about radical identification or radical identity between the two elements, or similarity, or overlap, or Venn diagram. So for instance, an example would be David's real world and classroom, right? I don't know about you, but competition, jealousy, scarce resources, racism, they're all in the classroom. I don't know what classrooms you all have been, but they're in my classrooms, right? That's a real world if there ever was one. And the classroom in the real world, if you're an ethnographer and you study culture, it's sort of everywhere. But I think wherever we are, the kinds of things that we learn in a classroom as we listen to someone is not that different from the kinds of things we can learn in the real world if we are listening. And part of what my job is, I think all good deans should be learners more than anything else, is thinking, adopting a learning position in pretty much everything so that you really have a better sense of what's going on. So think for a second as an experiment as you struggle with your binary about radical identification between the two elements and see what you come up with. X is Y and Y is, right? Think, let me just do this for a second right now. Humanities is the sciences. Sciences is the humanities, woo-hoo, right? Work hard is playing hard. Playing hard is working hard. Curricular is the co-curricular. The co-curricular is the curricular. Huh, this is a good one. Parents major is your passion major. Ouch. Passion major is your parents major. Ouch. That's going to involve a good family conversation, right? Wall Street is a Peace Corps. Peace Corps is Wall Street, right? It's really interesting things to do there. I'll end with that and just say that this way of thinking, I think, can really help us move into what David was saying earlier about a better form of intellectual community as well as social community with ourselves if we take the time to reflect on those binaries even as we're engaging in them. And that means, you know, I'm learning this wonderful phrase that I started to learn about 2 or 3 years ago from Claude Steele called microaggression, which is, you know, little comments that people make that put you down or that, you know, are slightly stereotypical. They're not huge. It's not like a structural problem, but it is always there as part of your everyday interactions. And I think that creating a different attitude around those microaggressions that can occur in binary relationships, right, like English versus another major, are really, really important for us to be aware of and to do as much as we can as we work through everyday binary conversations. And maybe I should end on a high note that's a very Dean-like announcement, but I just raised $500,000 for integrating social entrepreneurship into every single department in arts and sciences. So I thought that that was a form of integration that you should all know about. So I'll end that way.
Well, I think we've got about, if we go to 1:15, we've got about 10 minutes. And as you were talking, I was kind of thinking, like, how hopeful should I be? Particularly about our world here at Duke. You began by saying that we are a culture taking responsibility for itself. And instead of some kind of top-down administrative movement, this is more of a bottom-up sort of culture thinking about its own growth and development. So I want to ask the students, like, where do you think we are in that process? Well, do you think we are taking responsibility for our own culture? Or are you guys waiting around for somebody to say, this is the way it's going to be? Do you feel any sense of movement? Or all these binaries, hey, 20 years from now, am I going to be having, well, 20 years from now, I'll be emeritus at about 80 years old. But could I still be in the same room saying all the same binaries that I said today with the same type of intensity? And I like what Laurie said about some of those binaries make me a little uncomfortable. Yara, what you got?
I think if you just look at, I've talked a lot, I'm sorry. But I mean, easily you can look back and look at the arguments that we were having 20 years ago, 50 years ago, 100 years ago, and they were different, and they did touch on the same idea of like working through binaries and fighting through binaries. But I do think that we should be hopeful about Duke and its culture and the idea of the students and the people involved taking ownership and modifying its culture. Because when you look at even how education as a department was approached 50 years ago versus how it's approached now, or how the students approach classes or the work hard, play hard binary, you can see change, and it will continue to change. Whether or not that change will be inherently like great, who knows? But the conversation will be different. It might still be about binaries, but it'll be different.
Amanda?
I think it would be unfair to judge our culture based on the binaries that we're talking about in 20 years, because I don't know if they really accurately represent everything that's going on even now.
Yep.
Also because students that come to Duke come from a world that also, you know, lives in that system. So isn't necessarily going to go away here or anywhere. It doesn't necessarily represent the real progress that's happening.
Amanda, I want to build on that comment because I think it's very astute in the following way. One of the things that I think about higher education that is a big, big obstacle is its own utopianism about itself, right? That, you know, there's this sort of sense, you know, I have this conversation every day where I'm kind of like, really, you thought that? That was possible, that there's a kind of ideal that people bring to any encounter, and that means that the reality is always much more disappointing for them, including things like universities should have every single subject taught. And there was a moment when certainly United States culture had wealth enough and universities had wealth enough where universities strove to be that. And then it was really clear that we can't all teach every single minor language, you know, that exists, to take an obvious example. So do we have to be, as universities, complete worlds unto ourselves in terms of curricula? The answer is we can't be economically. So that's one form of utopianism. Another is one that I heard all the time when I was a department chair, which is people lacking intellectual community. They say, oh, I really don't have intellectual community here. And I was feeling completely overwhelmed with intellectual community, like how many cool conversations could I be having? And you know, with different seminars and groups and so on. And I always wondered about that, because then I'd say, well, aren't you part of this seminar and that seminar and that seminar? I was, yeah, but I'm still missing intellectual community. And I'm like, it's kind of right in front of you. So there are these ways in which I think we do come particularly to the academy with very, very high expectations, which sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes inform a kind of narrative of disappointment, because it is so much like the real world.
Barbara, you had...
Well, I think one of the things you bring up that's interesting is sort of the relationship too between multiple dichotomies. So what I was thinking about was, when you think about imagining new ways of looking at things, right? I think a lot of times we think that knowledge is outside of us. Like, it's out there, we just have to discover it. And we don't necessarily say, oh, look, let me look at my life. I live in the intersection of all of these, you know, I think about Pauline Murray's life this way a lot. She lives in this intersection of all these identities. So what's that perspective like from there? What would it look like if we looked at any intellectual question or subject from that perspective?
Right.
Or from any of our perspectives? And then, isn't it interesting that, you know, for me anyway, that while that sometimes, you know, when we think about generations of young people, often we faculty talk about people in your age as people who grew up with parents who say, you're good no matter what you do, you're great, you know, there's not this sort of, you know, container around that, which is just really different from the way we grew up. So how do we operate in this to create that space in that intersection, but also then for that space to be influenced by that binary of responsibility to self, responsibility to community, which is one of the binaries I think is really positive. I think it asks us these really important questions about, well, yeah, I want to make the space where I can imagine myself, where I can imagine a solution, an idea, a framework that's really coming out of the experience, you know, something that's coming out of my brain, you know, not looking, not needing that to be outside, and how powerful that is, and how powerful that is when we think about new ideas and innovation and new perspectives and creating those ways of getting beyond those obstacles. But on the other hand, what are the binaries we sort of put in place? Because the binary of the system you operate in can be very oppressive. That there has to be an answer, yes or no, to that donation.
Right.
You know, that system can be oppressive. Yet these other systems, like this one I'm suggesting, between responsibility to self, responsibility to community, is actually kind of a good governor, in my opinion.
Yeah.
So it's sort of interesting to think about how to combine both inviting binaries that can be, we can put in our way, in some sense, as obstacles we want to have to face, but also opening up the space where we say, well, I just am going to reject that binary. You know, you see a lot of young people doing that around gender, around sexuality, around identity. You know, don't ask me to be one or the other. I'm going to inhabit a space that I'm going to define.
Right.
And I'm going to tell you what that's all about instead of looking for those answers outside.
Yeah, I think that's very powerful. Lots of people jumping in, so I'll just listen for a little bit.
I was going to say, actually, that I like the way this is kind of coming back around to the speech that you gave before, in the sense that you kind of started out by saying a binary doesn't have to be a bad thing. If you think about it, actually, thinking about the nature of a binary can be your question,
mm-hmm.
right?
Absolutely.
I'm an ecologist, and so I think a lot about the relationship between self and culture. You know, how do we make culture enhance culture make us? And if I ever resolved that question, if I ever answered it, I would be so bored.
Yeah,
exactly. The binary drives me.
Right.
Intellectually, you know, and
great.
I don't want it to be solved.
Exactly.
I feel like it's an interesting problem because it's unresolved.
Yeah, it's a great point.
Yeah, I was kind of going off what Heather said. I had a college as well. But my field is ethnic relations, and so it's by definition built on understanding how binaries work. And yes, it would be great if we could eliminate that binary, but it exists in society right now, and even it's kind of just the idea of, is a colorblind society good right now? If Duke was truly colorblind, is that actually good? No, because it ignores the fact that there is a difference in the way people are able to access X, Y, and Z. So this idea of binary and how it impacts relationships and the understanding of the multifaceted in the binary and multifaceted identifications, actually, I found in my, that's my academic side, in my community development work, is that defining the binary and then using the binary as a launch pad to discuss similarities as well as difference and allow people to own their ethnic binary. You know, I have an identification that is this and that's acceptable. I think it's a, it makes it a much more complex, not binary as a thing, but binary as a process.
Right, that's great.
You know, when you, as you were talking, it reminded me of something Laurie said earlier about somebody maybe winning the binary, like sciences and humanities. And I think one of the things that happens in my mind is that it seems easy to recognize who's winning a particular binary in certain cases. Or there's perception that there's an inequity in the power relationship between the binary.
Right.
And that becomes a little problematic if those inequities exist. We're almost out of time, but I saw a couple of hands up. Stephanie, you wanted to?
Yeah, I wanted to say that I appreciated you talking about how problems are resolved. And at the same time, I struggle in like how much time, how many resources, how many relationships or what type. I was thinking about from last night, knowing BSAI is going on here.
Right.
And I think that's a perfect example of some students or people walking around, why do we still have it? We had black students admitted to Duke 50 years ago, and yet we still have a need to bring these students in. And so we struggle with the extent to making them feel comfortable and welcomed and affirmed, but also integrating them in when they come here. They won't have a BSAI experience on a day-to-day basis. They'll be having a Duke experience that is not at all necessarily like 200 or 300 students in a room together. And then I'm affirmed that, yes, that needs to happen, because in one of the other hats I wear, I chair a bias incident response team in student affairs. And so just this morning I come in and I see, you know, some emails that the university has gotten that was very negative toward many groups that we could mention, which is this white versus other. So I'm reminded that we still need different mechanisms. We need those kinds of experiences. And even though the perception may be out there, as David's saying, that we don't, we still have to struggle with that binary, because things outside of our walls, and even sometimes again, have not changed.
Yeah, I think that's such a powerful point, because if we can be positive, if not utopian, about where the academy is, we do better with complexity than many parts of society are at our best. And the problem and the danger there, I've just written a little piece about this in relationship to women, is that when you have a narrative of progression, so that you've only, then you've resolved it, then the temptation is therefore to check it off. So we now know what complexity is and how to deal with multiple identities and the intersectionality that Barbara was talking about. And so therefore those who don't, or those who might want to say, this is my primary identity right now, or however that might work, there's a problem there. But even more importantly, we become incredulous when the basics of racism, sexism, et cetera, are still around us. I fear sometimes we lose our toolbox to deal with those very basic things that have to exist at that primary level at the same time as we're up there on the tertiary level. So I think that that's very important. Maybe I'll end with a story that I've always loved to send all of us on our way, which is one of the biggest binaries is the animal nature versus higher nature, and that's something that you see in many different writings and many different world traditions, and East and West. And Parker Palmer has a great way of thinking about this, because he felt he was struggling all his life with depression, and he had a very, very bad bout of it. And in the one of the bouts of depression, he said he felt like he lost his soul, and lost his spirit, lost his soul, and he couldn't find it. And he said the way that he climbed out of his depression was to re-imagine himself and to connect himself back with the animal that he was, with his animal nature, with the animal that enjoyed simply taking naps in the sun with all legs extended, with the person who loved to yawn as a way of greeting someone, the person who was almost hungry to the point of rapaciousness, and so on. And that was the way he got out of his depression, was to reconnect with that sort of very animal nature. And he said what he realized in that process was that the animal was the soul, and the soul was the animal. So I thought that's a really dramatic binary that we all deal with in some way or other. So I thought I'd leave you with that story.
That's a great story. You know what? Let's give it up. I got an idea for our next event. We're all busy now, but next fall, sunny day, we get together. We get together in Duke Gardens. And we just all take a nap in the sun, and we reconnect with our animalistic souls. Well, thank you all for coming, and we hope you have a wonderful rest of the weekend.
Produced by Duke University. Online at duke.edu.